having completed the 17th chapter of the Gita, now we will enter into the 18th chapter. This is the final chapter of the Gita and the biggest chapter, consisting of 78 verses. Lord Krishna started his teaching to Arjuna from the second chapter onwards. The entire first chapter was devoted to prepare the ground in which Arjuna, the soldier, was converted into Arjuna, the disciple, and Krishna, the driver, was converted into Krishna, the Gita-charya. So the entire first chapter was devoted for this conversion, and then the actual teaching began from the second chapter, and that too from the 11th verse onwards. Thus we have 17 chapters of the Gita teaching. And here Lord Krishna uses the well-known method of teaching, which I had often referred to, and the method of teaching is Sankshepa Vistarabhyam Bodhanam. First give a bird's eye view, first give a capsule form of the whole teaching, so that the student will know what he or she is in for. This initial summarization of the teaching is called Upakrama Sankshepaha or Upakrama Sangrahaha. Nutshell teaching in the beginning. And this Lord Krishna did in the second chapter of the Gita. The second chapter contains the essence of the entire Gita teaching. And thereafter, this summary, this capsule version, was magnified in the chapters from the 3rd up to the 17th. 15 chapters, 3rd to 17th, 15 chapters, and correct. 15 chapters are the magnification, the elaboration, the vistara of the summary given in the second chapter. And after elaborating in 15 chapters from the 3rd to the 17th, Krishna summarizes the whole teaching once again. This is the second summarization done at the end. We call it Upasamhara Sankshepaha. So thus, mini version, maxi version, and again mini version, mini, maxi, mini. Erena nanchunvadadengo, I mean the teaching. Okay. So mini, maxi, mini teaching is the method that is to be adopted. And I have given you the example of the news also. They start the news reading by giving you the headlines first. Then it is elaborated. Then it is concluded again with the main news. Sankshepa Vistara Sankshepaha. Now the 18th chapter happens to be the final summary of the elaborate teaching given in 15 chapters of the Gita from the 3rd to the 17th. And in these 15 chapters, Lord has dealt with mainly 9 topics, about which also I have mentioned, but I would like to remind. The first 3 important topics are sadhana traya vicharaha, the threefold spiritual disciplines which are to be compulsorily followed by every seeker to attain spiritual freedom. The threefold sadhanas being karma yoga sadhana for purification of mind, upasana yoga sadhana for the integration of the mind, and jnana yoga sadhana for the enlightenment or for the removal of ignorance. The sadhana trayam in the form of karma, upasana, bhakti yoga, these are the 3 main topics that Krishna discussed. And there too, the first 6 chapters concentrate on karma yoga. Then the second 6 chapters, from the 7th to the 12th chapter, it is upasana yoga pradhana. And from the 13th to the 17th is jnana yoga pradhana. 3 spiritual disciplines were discussed. Then we get another 3 important topics. We will call it padatraya vicharaha, analysis of the 3 significant words occurring in the Mahavakyam, the central teaching of the Vedanta. The Mahavakyam, known as the great equation, Tat, Tvam, Asi. It is called Mahavakyam because it is the central teaching. And this Mahavakyam has got 3 words. Tat, referring to Ishvara Swarupam. Tvam, referring to Jiva Swarupam. And Asi, referring to the Aikyam or Oneness. Thus, Tat Tvam Asi declares the essential oneness of God, the macrocosmic self, and the individual, the microcosmic self, the individual self and the universal self identity. And the first 6 chapters of the Gita focus on the Jiva Swarupam, Tvampada Vichara. The next 6 chapters, 7 to 12, is Tatpada Vichara, Ishvara Swarupam. And the last 6 chapters, Asipada Vichara, the Aikyam or Oneness. Thus, Padatraya Vicharaha, Vicharaha means analysis, is contained in the Gita teaching. And then we have got another 3 important topics, which deal with the factors which are required for any success in life, especially spiritual success. 3 factors play prominent role for attaining any success, especially spiritual success. I will call them ghatakatraya vicharaha. Ghatakatraya means 3 important factors contributing to success. And those 3 important factors are, number 1, individual effort, prayatna, one's own application of the mind. Prayatna is factor one. We can call it effort or appropriate employment of the free will that is given to us. Which means I should accept that I have a free will. There are many people who do not accept a free will at all. Krishna says, spiritual success requires first the acceptance of a free will. And having accepted the free will, I should employ it appropriately. That is factor number one contributing to success. Then the second prominent factor is prasadaha. Prasadaha means the grace of the Lord. You may call it purva janma punyam, but we generally call it Ishvara prasadaha, Ishvara anugrahaha or daivam. Thus prasada is the second important ghataka. Ghataka means factor. And the third and equally important factor is the character. Unless a human being has a healthy character consisting of healthy values and healthy attitudes, success is impossible, especially spiritual success. Now, new analysis is showing that even material success requires character. New management studies and new books which are arriving, they are coming to the conclusion that even huge corporations require character for long-term success. If an institution compromises with values, they may get short-term success, but long-term success requires character. And it is coming from the West. If it comes from the West, we will accept. Gita shunna kakamatam. And the Stephen Covey chilurthirukar. Our one, the 7 steps for the successful person. Oh, no. And he comes to the conclusion, after making the statistical study of all the big companies, that character is very important. So, whether it is material or spiritual success, character is the third factor. Prayatna, prasada, and sadgunaha. And in the Bhagavad Gita, the first 6 chapters focus on the prayatna part. And the next 6 chapters focus on prasada part. And the last 6 chapters focus on what is left out, sadguna part. That is why the 16th chapter and the 17th chapter, 2 full chapters, were exclusively dedicated for character building in the name of Daivi Sampat or in the name of Sattva Guna. Character is technically called Sattva Guna or Daivi Sampat. Thus, Sadhanatrayam, then Padatrayam and Ghatakatrayam, these are the 9 topics which are covered in the 15 chapters of the Gita, namely from the 3rd to the 17th. Second And 18 chapters are the summary of this teaching. And therefore, when we are studying the 18th chapter, Krishna will assume that we have gone through the previous chapters, and he will only remind us the topics discussed before, and therefore, it will not be elaborated. So, I will also assume that you are in touch with the previous chapters we studied. I will not take too much for granted. Konjana, I will explain a little bit also. I will have a balanced approach. With this background, we will enter into the 18th chapter. Atha ashtadashodhyayah. Arjuna uvacha. Sannyasasya mahabaho. Tattvamit. Chami veditum. Tyagasya cha Rishikesha. Prithakeshi Nishudana. In spite of so many chapters of clear teaching, and that too coming from the Sakshat Narayana himself, Arjuna manages to have questions and doubts. So you can imagine how knowledge is not that easy. It involves elaborate dialogue. One cannot give knowledge just like that. It is not a material to be handed over. It requires consistent teaching for a length of time. And every statement leads to newer and newer questions called anuprasna. And the teacher will have to clarify, it will remove the doubt but will produce another. That is why we said knowledge takes place through consistent and systematic dialogue. And in spite of this elaborate dialogue, at least the version that we get, Arjuna manages to have a doubt. And now this is the last question raised by Arjuna, which is the seed for the entire 18th chapter. And Arjuna's question is regarding sannyasa or renunciation. Renunciation is one topic which has been bugging Arjuna's mind. And Arjuna has special interest in sannyasa in this context. In fact, everybody will get interest in sannyasa at certain moments. What moments? When there are problems. When everything is fine, nobody talks about renunciation, kachimuch. But when there are problems around, people think of Rishikesh, people think of ashramas. And Arjuna also, when he was actually in forest, he never talked about sannyasa. In fact, that was the ideal place, ange irukka vendirudane. So, at that time, he very badly wanted to get back his kingdom. But now, in the battlefield, when his duty happens to be a bitter duty, wherein he has to kill his own kith and kin, with whom he has got intense attachment, the duty is very, very unpalatable. and he wants to escape from the duty, and he wants some justification for that, and the ideal justification is what? Sannyasa. Therefore, even at the end of the first chapter, we saw Arjuna dropped his bow and arrow, and he even said, a life of sannyasa is better. And then, because of some punyam, he surrendered to Lord Krishna and asked for the teaching, hoping that Krishna will prescribe sannyasa. Many times we go to Swamis with questions, but we don't want Swami's answer. We want a particular answer coming from Swami, so that my answer is validated. Most people come for validation rather than clarification. And until you give the answer that they want, thirupi kettinde irupa, they will present in this way, that way. And the moment they get an incline, namma nenekkira maadhiri Swamiji solrar, Swamiji, neenga romba correct nodu. They give certificate to Swamiji. So therefore, Arjuna wanted sannyasa. And he was waiting for Krishna to endure sannyasa. And Krishna was, if Arjuna is smart, Krishna is smarter. Because Krishna knew Arjuna is thinking of escapist sannyasa. Escapist sannyasa will never work. If you have problem, never take sannyasa when there is problem. Solve the problem, and when everything is fine, then take sannyasa if you want to. So therefore, Krishna never wanted to talk about sannyasa. Therefore, Krishna gave a new definition to sannyasa, which is totally different from the traditional, conventional definition. What is the conventional definition of sannyasa? A monastic life in which a person gives up everything and leaves home and snaps his ties with everyone and everything. This monastic lifestyle is the conventional sannyasa, and it is talked about in the scriptures, and it is an elaborate ritualistic procedure, and it is called vaidha sannyasa, it is called ashrama sannyasa. This is the conventional meaning, and it is this sannyasa that Arjuna wanted, so that he can get out of this war. Because sannyasi should not fight. But what does Krishna do? Instead of giving this traditional, conventional definition, Krishna gives a new definition, and that definition is what? Karma yoga itself is the real sannyasa. Thus, the karma yoga way of life, followed by a grihastha, is sannyasa. Anashrita karma phalam karyam karma karoti yaha, sasanyasi cha yogi cha naniragnirna chakriyaha, yam sanyasamiti prahur yogam tam viddhi pandava, Nahya sanyasta sankalpo yogi bhavati kashchana. In the 6th chapter, in the first 2 verses, Krishna said, this monastic person is not a real sannyasi. The kavi uditsindrukkana olliyo, avalla sannyasi kadayadu nutar. And then he said, a grihastha who gives up strong raga dvesha. So a grihastha has a tendency to develop strong attachment and aversion to the things and people around, avoidance of this raga and dvesha is sannyasa. So sannyasa is what? Raga dvesha renunciation, remaining in grihasthashrama is sannyasa, he said. Thus, what is sannyasa? Karma yoga, in which raga dveshas are renounced, is sannyasa. And even though this is an ingenious and wonderful definition, Arjuna is not happy because this definition does not suit him. Because he cannot escape and take to monastic order. And therefore, Krishna, Arjuna is repeatedly asking about this only. He questions Krishna again and again, assuming that at least one time Krishna will prescribe the monastic sannyasa, the life of a monk. And in the 18th chapter beginning, is the last desperate attempt of Arjuna. And once again he asked Lord Krishna, Krishna, please tell me what is sannyasa. As though Krishna has not talked about this, Krishna has talked about this several times. As I said in the 6th chapter itself, he has talked about, but Arjuna wants to get his definition from Krishna's mouth. Like reporters want to take out statements from politicians. And people go to do Adumadri Arjuna wants to take out, and therefore he asked the final question. So, he Mahabahu, Arjuna addresses Lord Krishna, O Lord, with powerful arms, sannyasasya tattvam veditum icchami. I would like to know the true meaning or significance of the word sannyasa. And the literal meaning of the word sannyasa is giving up. Sam plus ni plus us is the root from which the word has come. The root is us, asyati, to throw away. Sam plus ni are prefixes. Two prefixes are there, sam and ni. Samnyas means total and appropriate renunciation. Not partial renunciation of inconvenient things. Total renunciation of all possessions, all relationships, all bank balance, all the titles, Swami so-and-so, M.A. Somebody had put, ellathayum vittuttu M.A. vidamudiyala. So you have to Padma Shri Swami, na? Title, very difficult to give up title. So therefore, sum means total and permanent. Uru maasathukku vittu thirupi vandu eduthukuren na, apdi illa. Total. And ni as ni means proper. There is a ritualistic method. Just as joining a company is done in a formal manner and you resign from the company also in a formal manner 3 months before, 2 months before, and you have to make sure somebody else takes over, there is a formal method. Similarly, when I take up duty, it is formally done. When I give up, that also must be formally done. This formal and complete renunciation is called sam ni as, formal, complete renunciation. This is the dictionary meaning of the word. Arjuna wants to know the significance of this term. Aham veditum icchami. Then Rishi Kesha, he addresses the Lord again. O Lord, the Lord of the sense organs, Rishikam means Indriyani. Isha means the Lord who blesses the sense organs, because Lord is the Chaitanyam, Shrotrasya Shrotram, Manaso Manoyatu. He alone enlivens all our organs, therefore is called Rishi Kesha. And another Sambodhana, Keshi Nishudana. O Lord, who is the destroyer of the Rakshasa, known as Keshi. Keshi is the name of a Rakshasa who appeared with a horse face, horse-faced Asura. And that Asura the Lord killed, therefore he is called Keshi Nishudana. So, O Lord, Tyagasya cha Tattvam Veditum Icchami. Adha randa andaram padichukanam. Tyagasya cha Tattvam Veditum Icchami. I would like to know the meaning of the word Tyaga also, which is another significant word used in the scripture. So, Sannyasa is one word. Tyaga is another word. Nakarmanana prajayadhanena tyage naike amrutatvamanashuhu. That is used. Vedanta vijnana sunishchitarthaha sanyasa yoga dyataya shuddhasatvaha. So, sanyasa is one word. Tyaga is another word. And what is the meaning of the word Tyaga? From the dictionary, the word Tyaga also we know is derived from the root Tyaj, to give up. The other is derived from the root As, Asyati, to give up. And here Tyaj, Tyajati, to give up. Tyagaha means what? Again, renunciation. So, do both the words convey the same meaning, or is there a shade of difference in these two words? And therefore, I would like to know the meaning of these two words. How? Prithak. Prithak means distinctly. I would like to know. So, Arjuna's last ditch attempt. Now, if Krishna says Tyaga is monastic life, or Sannyasa is monastic life, Yedu Kavi, and also Rishikesh is near Delhi, near Kurukshetra, only few hours, Madras Liana, the Yojipon, so it is very close by. So this is Arjuna's question, Krishna is going to answer. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, Kamyanam Karmananyasam, Sanyasam Kavayo Viduhu, Sarva Karma Phalat Tyagam, Prahustyagam Vichakshanah. Bhagavan begins to give his answer from this verse. In the second and the third verses, Lord Krishna gives the opinion of some sages or some scholars. So, these two verses are within quotation. These are not the views of the Lord, but these are the views of some scholars, and Lord Krishna is going to disagree with them, at least partially. Therefore, from the fourth verse, we will know the clear answer. But here, Krishna gives the answer according to some other scholars. Renunciation is primarily associated with karma or action. Even though renunciation is associated with all things, including possessions and relationship, generally, renunciation is associated with karma or activity. In fact, that is the toughest job also. Because not to do anything is the toughest thing. An idle mind is a devil's workshop. Krishna himself said before, Nahi kaschit shanamapi jatu tishtati akarmakriti. Yadhavdi Tirishaman, something or the other we have to do. That's why retirement becomes a very, very big headache, not only for the retiring fellow, but the other family members also. And therefore, they also suggest, innuru vela eduthundu ponga onuduva. So therefore, it suits everyone. It's very difficult to remain quiet. Summa irundu sugam varuvadu eppozhudhu nana. Very difficult. Therefore, generally, renunciation is associated with karma. And in the Shastra, karmas are divided into five types, which I have talked about before, but you can briefly note here. One is called vihita karma, compulsory duties. Number two, sakama or kamya karma, optional activities to be taken to if you want to, optional activities. Then nishiddha karma, prohibited activities. Third one. The fourth one is prayaschitta karma. Prayaschitta karma, that is a remedial activities, an action done to remedy a nishiddha karma. Prayaschitta karma becomes relevant when nishiddha karma is done. And finally, naimittika karma, occasional duties when the situation arises. So, when the children are born, what are the duties which will not be relevant if the children are not there? If the children are grown up, what are the duties which will not be relevant when they are babies? If grandchildren are born, what are the duties? So, thus they come under occasional duties. So, vihita karma, kamya karma, nishiddha karma, prayaschitta karma, naimittika karma, five types of karmas are there. Based on that, some people differentiate sannyasa and tyaga. What is the differentiation? Some scholars say, kamyanam karmanam nyasam sannyasam. Renunciation is giving up of four types of karma other than the first type. What is the first type? Vihita karma, compulsory duties. Adamatram vechindu giving up of all other karmas. What are they? Kamya karma, prayaschitta karma, nishiddha karma. So, giving up of kamya karma and the other, etc., is understood, is called sannyasaha, according to some scholars. That means what? One should retain nitya karma, and even naimittika karma is considered to be compulsory. So, rendu vithikala, 1 and 5 are compulsory, 2 and 3 and 4.